This is the CCD podcast, covering all your cultural compulsive disorders. We are back once again in the Suckhole for our part two of our sit down with the Sucklord. Thanks again for having us here, Sucklord.
Yeah.
And my good friend Amit Saxena back once again.
How's it going?
How you guys doing?
Super duper peachy keen.
Super duper peachy keen. That's way too much energy.
Bring it down?
Bring it down. Scotch.
Okay.
So today we're going to get into Star Wars. Fucking Star Wars. Star Wars that has been ever present in all of our fucking lives and is back again, bigger than ever, even though it's probably never really left our worlds, but it's back in a whole fucking way that I never ever conceived that it would ever be back in. You know, like I sort of figured we would get more Star Wars at some point, but not like this. Not quite like this. Brand new movie. I never thought we'd be getting episode 7 with fucking Han Solo, Luke Skywalker, and Princess Leia in this fashion.
And a new movie every year for like
forever.
You know,
I don't know about all that shit, but yeah, I mean, like we may get a little bit too much at some point, but I'm game.
Well,
I'm game.
What? I mean, too much. I would not put that beer next to your computer.
Yeah, it's a good, this is actually a good, very good tip. It's every year, maybe a little overkill, but we'll see. I mean, they're cranking out three more Marvel movies a year now, and they're still making big bucks. But
I think there's enough material that it'll be fine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So The Force Awakens is what's coming out in December, episode 7. All kinds of speculation. I mean, it's crazy.
Yeah.
And we're about like 3 months away now, give or take.
No. Well, let's see.
We're
August,
close.
September, October, November.
Oh yeah,
December.
We're
comes out like at Christmas.
Yeah. December 19th.
5 months.
So we're getting pretty close. We're at the halfway
too
mark.
Too soon, if you ask me.
Yeah.
I'm not. No. I don't know if I'm prepared.
Emotionally
right?
ready.
It's gonna change everything.
How do you guys feel about a Star Wars movie in December? Does it really matter if it's not a May release?
I don't give a shit.
Yeah. Me neither.
I'll get into it. I think they are super smart for doing it. I think it's gonna make a whole ton of money in December.
Well, I mean, it was gonna be for May, but they didn't think they could get it done.
Right.
And I mean,
they made it in a shorter time frame than all the other films.
I much rather prefer they take their time, obviously, and do what they got to do.
But they're going to do them at 2 year intervals, right? I think these are.
Yeah,
gonna be
but
two,
I'm also guessing, like at this point, the technology is advanced enough that 2 years is enough.
And they've got the different directors for each one, so they're probably already prepping
the next
one.
Well, they've already started doing Rogue One.
Right.
They've already started filming that. They say using some of the existing Force Awakens set, so it's like a living. It's almost like a TV show, right? They're filming almost like multiple TV shows at the same time, kind of thing, which totally makes sense. They're all still giant fucking movies, of course, but Star Wars, you know, love Star Wars.
Star Wars.
Been through it my entire life, you know, original movies, and then there was sort of that dark time between Jedi and Phantom Menace.
And then there was the dark time after Phantom Menace.
No shit. No
where,
shit.
You know, a generation was just collectively let down.
Yeah.
And then had to come to terms with that. And yet, there's a promise of a renewal. That's why I almost think that the name of the movie is pretty genius.
Yeah, The Force Awakens.
Yeah, because it implies more than just what's happening in the film. It implies what's happening in the world of being a Star Wars fan.
I mean, they've been hitting that hard marketing-wise, like practical effects, real sets. Yeah. Like they keep they're catering for fucking us.
Absolutely, they're absolutely catering to this.
But
generation.
I mean, it's probably I would also guess a sort of natural trend, a reaction in general to the ascent of CG effects. It's great. I think it's a very useful tool in telling great stories and making great spectacles and in service to a good story in the hands of a good director. And if it's done right, it's an amazing tool. Have we seen it overdone or used to ill effect or been the sort of feature of the film rather than the characters and the story? Yes, but I think now that it's the novelty of it is sort of settled in and now it's just a thing in the toolbox, the sort of return to practical effects is a nice balance. Like they're, you know, trying to figure out how to make the best film.
There'll be plenty of CG,
of CG
in this too.
Yeah.
One of the things I thought was really interesting is they were doing motion capture, which we're very familiar with, motion capture, and then you create a CG character, but they were having an actor doing motion capture on set and then taking those movements and putting them onto an animatronic character. So that it's a blend of that CG motion right. capture, but then on a practical effect, which I'm like, that's fucking amazing. Yeah.
What you mean, like a robot?
Yeah, like yeah. so those guys who would they would do it with a remote control back in the day on like Jedi, but now they're getting the actor's performance to come through nuanced.
Into
I just learned that from Comic-Con.
Yeah,
it was in one of the Comic-Con reels they showed,
that's
and I was
great.
Like, yeah. I've never fucking heard about that. Kind of thing. It's a perfect blend, a compromise.
Yeah. I mean, it's interesting with this kind of throwback, and everybody's trying to go back to what they did in the originals. Part of the genius and part of the extra part of what Star Wars was, though, is that it was always breaking ground in terms of technology. And so, pardon me when they were like, oh, we're going back to film, we're going to do all this practical stuff. Obviously, I love it for all the reasons we love that stuff. But part of me was like, I hope we're still innovating here. I hope we're still moving technology forward, because that's how George Lucas got digital theaters to happen, because he said, this is going to be in a Star Wars movie, so people better start doing it. And so, that's how you kind of push it.
The thing is, I still like, we all know that there was something a bit lacking in the story and the performance of the prequels, but they did serve as a vehicle for George Lucas to develop the technology. It's like, I think almost his passion was more towards that than the actual telling of the Star Wars
possible.
Film. So it's like, okay, granted, the movies themselves aren't amazing stories, but how they've advanced filmmaking is really significant. So I definitely give him credit for that, even though, he's already given us 2.5 amazing Star Wars films beforehand. We could talk about Return of the Jedi.
Sure.
And then the prequels, okay, the stories were bad, but the tools that he created are incredibly valuable, and now in the hands of other people that have a fresh approach to things, combined with the incorporation of what worked in the older analog methods, is a good thing.
One of the best things to come out of the prequels is the Clone Wars TV show, which I didn't get into at first, but eventually I picked it up, and I'm like, they told great stories. Yeah. It really felt like Star Wars, and it was in that prequel universe. So I'm like, it's not necessarily that universe that was so terrible, but maybe some of the,
All right. I'm just going to jump in here.
Amit's a huge prequel guy.
I know that I am actually a huge prequel guy. I love the prequels. I could discuss them up and down for hours.
Okay, so what are the common things that you find people criticize the prequels for that you consider to be unfair?
Well, I don't know if it's necessarily unfair, because I don't want to say people's opinions are unfair.
Why? But opinions are contestable.
Okay, I hate people. Let me just tell you. The what happened with the prequels, part of me, there's an emotional reaction to what happened to the fan community afterwards, because it used to be a loving. You like Star Wars, you were my buddy. And then it became...
We're united in our hate.
Exactly. And then it became, some people like the prequels, some people don't like the prequels, right. And it became a lot of tearing down. And I love the analysis part of it. I dig that stuff back on the old message boards. We used to break it down into what the characters' motivations were.
One of the best
things
about being a Star Wars fan.
Yeah, absolutely. But then it became like, is this good or is this not good? And that's not fun for me. That's kind of what took me a little bit out of the nerd community in a lot of ways. Because, when you hear people tell you that something that you have an emotional connection to is crap, you'd start saying, all right, after a while you start getting tired of fighting it. I don't know what people's criticisms are that I really can really say. I think the story, if it doesn't resonate with you, then it doesn't resonate with you, but I think that the story was kind of ingenious. And if you go back to read some of the old George Lucas interviews from like the early 80s, before they even started doing this, he would lay out, I read some interview years ago where he said, I didn't make the prequels first. Obviously, he didn't make the prequels first because he didn't write them. I mean, if he wants to say that, he's lying. But he didn't make them first because he didn't think they would sell well, because he thought the classic hero's journey of 4 to 6 was more of a sellable piece. And I can completely understand that. The way he described what he envisioned the prequels at the time was Machiavellian, very dark, very humorless. And you can almost say that he was trying to address that in episode 1 by injecting Jar Jar to try to give it some humor, or aiming it towards kids so that the real meat of the story, which was the political story, in a way can be palatable to people. Again, if it doesn't hit you, then it doesn't hit you. I'm not going to tell you you're wrong.
No, but what I would say is I don't think it required the pandering.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, even when I was a 8-year-old kid watching episode 4, one of my favorite scenes in the whole movie was when they're in the Death Star just arguing about what's going on with the Senate. And it's just a talky scene, but it was interesting material.
Yeah.
The performance was great, and it had that really tense moment with Darth Vader. And it didn't have anything else going on, and it was just an acting performance. and backstory, and I thought it was fine. As an 8-year-old kid, I love that scene. Yeah. So I didn't think it was a smart move for the prequels to kind of simplify all that stuff.
I definitely felt there were calculations with the prequels that I don't know if I necessarily even agree with, despite my love of it. And that's one of them. Sure. I can understand that. And like even bringing Jango Fett in, I'm sure was a calculation to say, let's get the fans back in by giving you somebody like that. But I think that I think that character is awesome.
I don't oppose any of that stuff. Yeah. I really thought the plot of the movies were fine.
Yeah.
I thought there was incredible actors. They all look great. I just thought there was something lacking in the execution and the fact that, you know, George Lucas is notoriously known for having a certain weak spot in that not being a very people-oriented person.
Absolutely.
Not necessarily being able to bond with his actors. And I think during the original Star Wars movie, because he was still kind of a powerless nobody and a huge personality like Harrison Ford just sort of took over and didn't really give him, you know, just did what he wanted.
Right.
It was almost like the movie was good in spite of the fact that George Lucas was directing the actors. He just had those three people. I mean, it was smart that he cast it as a trio, but he got such a dynamic trio that it almost carried itself. And I think, and I'm understanding that this is a little bit of a taboo thing to say, you know, in that camp, but that his wife, Marsha Lucas, was also a huge influence.
Hell yeah. Sure. She edited the first
one. She edited, not only did she edit the films, she was the script doctor.
Yeah.
So, like, all the zingers and the humor and the little banter and all the little parts that sort of humanize it were all her contribution. Yeah. And you can see in Return of the Jedi, when after their relationship started falling apart, that voice is not there and it's much more diminished. And by the time you get to Phantom Menace, it's completely gone.
Sure. And at that point, he's 100% in control of every single thing.
Yes, which is, I just think, I wish I don't want to criticize him because even though I'm still
a
huge admirer of George Lucas, because I'm trying to emulate him, I also have to sort of pay some attention to his failings. And I think I wish he had just been a little bit more aware of what his limitations were and had somebody fuck with the scripts a little bit. And maybe help him direct the actors. Like, he could have directed the big picture, coordinating with the effects and all that. But just have a real personal guy, or a guy like Irvin Kershner, who can sit there and really bring out the emotion in a scene. I mean, I felt like the actors didn't know what they were doing, didn't have great dialogue to work with, and are just sort of like, you know, just sort of like going through the motions. You know, that's what I think were the sort of biggest weaknesses of those films. And I just thought if there had just been a little bit more heart to it, it would have been fine.
But I still, even though I have some problems with them too, I liked, you know, we did the Star Wars line for all three movies, and like that was a very fun experience. Right. And even if that was the only, even if the movies were even worse than they are, if I had that experience, I was still pretty happy, you know, with that.
It is funny, and as time has gone on, the nostalgia, would go back to the word nostalgia, but now there's nostalgia even amongst us who we've known each other, and you know, since then, for that time, you know, these movies which people have very strong negative feelings for, but we still love that time period. It's almost like thinking back to your youth and the original trilogy, you know, in that, in a way, just of having memories that are strong for us.
But it's funny too, because it's like we had like our first childhood when the original trilogy came out, and then we were granted a second childhood when we were in our 20s, early 30s, where we also had that experience. And maybe it was a very Generation X kind of experience where, we all had this beautiful thing that brought us together, but the thing itself was kind of somehow we all just like banded together and found a way to make a community and make it work. And now we're having a third go at it, you know, and there's a possibility that maybe some of the things that weren't so good about the middle part of it are going to be improved. And I think that's a great cure for like middle-aged cynicism.
Absolutely.
Like to be pushing 50 and still being just as psyched about something as I was when I was 8 is pretty incredible.
It is.
And the fact that even though there was like a sort of angstful middle ground, the fact that that's not how it ended is really powerful.
It is. Well, you brought it back, and just to go back to where we started from with the Clone Wars, was, you know, the one difference that was between now and then was there was no dark period. You know, the Clone Wars came out right after, and it was good, and it kept your interest, and it certainly kept the kids' interest, because you
kids
see,
fucking love it.
Yeah. And that's hugely important. Yeah.
Kids fucking love it. And kids even who grew up in the prequels, like a kid who was like 7 or 8 years old for episode 1 is like, 25 now. Yeah, you know, it's
so upsetting.
They might be having the same experience we had when we were seeing the prequel.
Yeah.
You never know.
Although they're probably going to get served better. Hey, can you give me another beer?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, that is probably what will happen. But, you know, it's, you know, we've talked earlier, art is subjective in some ways.
Some extent, but I think you can objectively argue certain strengths of the original trilogy were just absent in the prequels, and you just can't argue against that.
I agree. And
I don't disagree with that, even as somebody who loves a prequel. I think that there's different strengths.
They're different strengths. I'm a cherry picker. It's like I there's probably about 40% of the prequels that I really like. You know, I love Count Dooku.
Sure.
Love Christopher Lee. I love Darth Maul. Mm-hmm. I like Jango Fett. I like the clones. I like Grievous. Mm-hmm. I liked all the new planets. I loved Palpatine. I thought he was great.
I mean, I thought that was, like, I thought the Palpatine stuff, particularly when you look at it in the context of what was going on in the world at the time, you know, it still had
the
some
9/11
social,
shit. Oh, yeah.
You know, perfect. Impact when you talk about that. And then there's other stuff that's just, you know, different strokes for different folks. You know, I had student-teacher relationships at the time that, you know, were meaningful, that I resonated with. You know, I had family stuff that kind of resonated with me at the same time. So, you know, for me, those movies, and then creating a whole new community around it, like, there's a lot of positive feelings but I could still go on and on about, you know, the nitty-gritty too.
Yeah, but it's also interesting though, because in a lot of ways the challenge of liking the prequels kind of in a way tells you what kind of person you are. Like, are you really an optimist or a pessimist? Because there was a lot of people that, like, George Lucas raped my childhood and I'm over it and fuck you and it's such a huge disappointment and I don't even want to fuck with it anymore. Goodbye. And other people were like, it wasn't all there for me, but I want to like it, and I'm going to try to see the good side of this thing and try to continue to be a fan, even though it's not as easy as it's not as automatic as it was.
That's
when
I
was a
kid. I think.
And I think that's fine too, because it's like,
absolutely,
you know, where do you want to be? You want to be happy or you want to be happy? You want no Star Wars or mediocre Star Wars? I'll take mediocre Star Wars.
I mean, how
over.
Much fun was it when the new movie came out?
Yeah.
It was really cool.
Yeah, it was
and it was
fun,
exciting, you know, and it was fun. And there were more toys and more things.
Yeah, but I gotta say though, I experienced the backlash, especially like after all the fucking anticipation. I'm sitting there in the movie and I knew I was already prepared for not liking Jar Jar, because it was a lot of pre-roll on that. And I was like, okay, he's probably not going to be great. So when he came on the screen, I suffered through it.
Sure.
It was really the scene where they're having dinner in Anakin's house with his mom.
Right.
And that's your laser sword, isn't it? Mm-hmm. That's when I got that sinking feeling. And I'm like, oh, man. Because this is just not coming across as genuine to me. And I remember a similar scene in episode 4 where Luke is sitting down with his aunt and uncle talking about his father and Biggs in the academy, and I was just completely convinced and committed to what Luke was going through, and I just didn't feel that, and I don't think it has anything to do with the fact of what my age was at the time. There's a sincerity in a film, and there's not, and I just felt like some of those scenes just felt just not quite real. And that's what kind of killed it for me.
Yeah. And it's interesting, we were just talking before we started that it's been as long from episode 1 till now as it was from the Return of the Jedi to episode 1, which seems crazy.
And we're somehow still alive and somehow still care about it.
And there's, but that dark period from at the end of Jedi was crazy. Like, I don't think there was anything really Star Wars, like an Ewok movie and like a cartoon.
Yeah, did you care at the time?
Nah, you know, it sort of ran its course a little bit, and it just sort of like petered out, you know? And
I mean, I think I was too young to really have that much to compare it to.
Right.
But it seemed like a logical thing. Okay, there's only going to be 3 movies, and the 3 movies are over, and
it seemed totally normal.
That's normal, yeah.
Now it's like nothing ever fucking goes away.
It's never going to.
But what I don't remember, which I do remember from the prequel era, is like at the end of the prequels, it had been clear there was going to be no 7, 8, and 9, even though we were promised 7, 8, and 9 when Empire Strikes Back came out. When Return of the Jedi came out, I don't remember what the word was on the new movies or what the expectation was. I think George Lucas said, oh, there's going to be a little bit of a break and then he's going to get back to it.
Yeah, and there was talk of prequels maybe
at
some point.
But did he say, he didn't give any time?
I don't think so. Timeline. So when
but
it,
he
when
didn't
we found
say
out.
No.
Right, he never
he said,
said
no. He said soon.
Yeah, he said at some point maybe.
Yeah,
but I think most people were just assuming that it wasn't going to happen. I think in those years.
Every few years, you might hear something in like Starlog, like he's talking about the early 90s, maybe, or this or that.
I don't remember necessarily caring.
Right.
or
I remember the Zahn trilogy being something that kind of brought me back.
That was later.
But yeah.
But I remember after the prequels were done, after Episode 3 came out, it was like, that's it, no more.
Right.
And then the Power of the Force 2 line came out, I think, in 95, which was sort of those diesel ones. And that was like the first Star Wars line in a long time.
But we knew there were new movies coming out at the time.
Well, then that was like the first of them almost like testing the waters. Yeah. And then the special edition came out in 97. And then it really started ramping up.
But when those Power of the Force figures came out, we already knew there was going to be a special edition.
He hadn't said it. Yeah, we absolutely.
It just didn't come out of nowhere. We knew there was going to be a Star Wars relaunch.
Yeah. But that was when it came back. And that's when I started, my fandom started getting a little bit more reignited.
Yeah, me too.
At that point. And even though those toys weren't the greatest, I did buy
all
of them.
I didn't know they sucked at the time.
Yeah. I was like, that's cool. They're big guys. That's fine.
It's just cool to see Star Wars on the shelves. That's what I remember. Because I wasn't a collector.
Those toys have like a super cult value now. Like people are really into them because they're sort of... And I mean, it's become a thing. A lot of these companies will release toys that don't look realistic. They have exaggerated features or large hands and stuff. And that was like, you know, had that. But people are into those. There's the chase figures, especially like if the Luke is a big one.
With the long lightsaber.
Trying to get him on card is a difficult
one. That's so weird because, I mean, I don't think they were very good. And I know you get that Star Wars myopia where you can't really tell if it's good or bad right away. It's just like, it's Star Wars, it's new, I love it, of course. And then it only over time do you realize, maybe that wasn't the strongest entry in the series.
But I love that line. The vehicles in that line were amazing because I think they were cast from the same molds as some of the originals. And so they were great. And you could buy them because you couldn't buy the old ones anymore, right? So I was really into that. Got a Millennium Falcon and an AT-AT. And
I was just psyched when they made Grand Moff Tarkin.
Right?
Yeah. I mean, even as a kid, I was like, kind of thought something was wrong there. It's like, okay, we got the Death Squad commander, but no Tarkin. All Tarkin, all you need to do to make this Grand Moff Tarkin is just not have the helmet on it. So what's going on here? I just didn't understand. I never understood that.
And special editions, people shit on those quite a bit now, but at the time, like, people were like on board.
Oh, yeah.
Even thought that the changes might be sort of cool and see that new CGI.
It was the first time you saw CGI. I mean, I still think the upgrades to the end Death Star battle, I mean, at least at the time, I was like blown away.
They went over pretty well.
Yeah.
You know, most of the problems I think people have are the further tinkerings he did, the DVD and the Blu-ray.
Yeah, some of that stuff was really bad. I really hated that he put Tamara Morrison's voice in there.
Yep.
Not that I'm against him, but that was a great performance. There's a million reasons why you can come up with why Boba Fett doesn't have the same accent as his
Nobody was wondering.
Nobody was wondering.
He had a fucking helmet on.
and who knows? He got shot in the throat. Yeah. Maybe it's not even the same person.
People move from state to state. They lose their accent.
You could lose an accent in 20 years. I just thought it was unnecessary.
No,
and his performance wasn't great. I'm sorry. He's a good actor, but just...
He was cool as Django.
I thought his performance as Django was great, particularly with the helmet off. I mean, I thought like he was somebody who you felt
one of the stronger characters in the film.
And some of those Obi-Wan Django, interplay scenes, you at least felt some tension there.
Yeah, I wanted more of that, actually. That
so what have we got? The Force Awakens, Rogue One announced, and I think they...
Fett and Solo. Now, I got a problem with that.
Okay.
I always rejected the notion that Boba Fett's obsession with Han Solo was anything other than professional.
Just money, right?
Just money. Well, Han Solo is the most elusive, glamorous, high stakes, high value target.
It's good bounty.
In the bounty hunter world. And that was the only reason he was interested in it. He probably, if anything, and it's touched on in some other things, had some sort of grudging respect for Han Solo because he was so difficult.
Sure.
And Han Solo was almost just like a sort of slightly lighter version of Boba Fett. Mm-hmm. So if they're going to set it up where somehow it's some sort of revenge thing or some sort of like grudge, get out of here with that.
It doesn't play in the movie though. Like there would be nothing in Empire that would make you think that that was the relationship, because he's super professional.
He's worth a lot to me.
Exactly.
One of the worst fucking Star Wars things was Rick McCallum talking about Episode 2 and talking about Django and Bubba and their relationship. And they were like, we're going to see like why Boba Fett has this deep-seated hatred for the Skywalker family.
Fuck that.
And we were like, have you ever seen a fucking Star Wars movie, Rick? Like, Luke and fucking Boba Fett have nothing to do with each other. Like, what are you talking about?
What I always thought was so great about Boba Fett is what a sort of emotionless gray area character he was.
Right.
I know my Boba Fett would work for the rebellion if they paid him enough.
Absolutely. Yeah. I hope that doesn't happen, though. They don't turn him good like fucking Storm Shadow or something.
No, he's not good. He's just going for the money. He's just into the money.
I mean, what's I've heard rumored, and you know, a Boba Fett prequel or whatever isn't the coolest thing, but like, you know, if you did like a Man with No Name sort of style Western with Boba Fett who doesn't talk,
well,
like,
that's the beauty of
that's kind of cool.
Yeah, if it was like a really almost minimalist dialogue film that's all just about what
stylistic.
Do we love about him. What always fucks up Boba Fett is when you reveal too much about him. Right. What made him such a great character from the days when all you knew him was this mail-away figure from, you know, for the new Star Wars movie is that, you know, he was so minimal. You didn't not need to know anything about him. Now that you've given him daddy issues and all this shit, there's enough of that in Star Wars. Right. You don't need him to do that. You know,
he's just a silent fucking awesome.
I don't dig the idea that somehow Mace Windu killing his father made him into what he was. I mean, Jango Fett was a fucking asshole.
Yeah. He was a bounty hunter.
He was a bounty hunter.
He didn't care who he was working for.
I mean, there's a lot of rumors. This is all speculation that, you know, the Boba Fett that we got is supposed to be not the Boba. Like, he got killed.
Yeah. See,
somebody took his armor
stuff.
And he's just... Acknowledge it at all. Just be what it is.
It's fine for X-Men. I don't want it in Star Wars.
Boba Fett
just embrace what it was.
He's one of the few characters that doesn't need a backstory.
Yeah, I agree. I honestly didn't think Han Solo needed a backstory.
It's going to be that. I mean, what the thing that disappointed me about the prequels was that I was always under the impression that there was 212 Mandalorian super commandos that fought on the side of the Empire, somebody during the Clone Wars, and Boba Fett was one of them. Like, why didn't we get, like, the Mandalorian army? They tried to do that in Clone Wars, which is pretty amazing.
Yes. Yeah.
But I always thought that was part of the canon, and I was sort of disappointed that it became another father and son drama.
Well, that's going to be an interesting thing with the new movies, too, because there was obviously, and again, not to make any judgments, but there was obviously a lot of, with the prequels, what did you think was going to happen? And that now we're no longer tied to that anymore. You know, whatever happens, happens. I mean, I know beyond the Zahn trilogy, I never really read any EU, but I know that they got rid of all that stuff.
Right.
And so, I'm glad for that.
Yeah, and so,
yeah that's no.
I never liked Dark Empire or any of that stuff. It just
It was always EU. It never counted.
It never
counted. If you make it a movie, it's over.
It counted at the time.
Sure,
if there was nothing to contest. It
counts. It counts to you whatever it meant.
I mean,
to you.
I was into the Marvel EU at the time. Mm-hmm.
I mean, that lasted forever. They're all back together now, Marvel and Star Wars.
Yeah.
That's the primary Star Wars imprint now. So Rogue One, right? I think that even more than The Force Awakens is going to be the deciding factor of whether they're going to be able to do this movie a year thing. Because Force Awakens is great.
It's going to be huge.
It's a little more of the same. You know, it's Star Wars.
It's
Skywalker.
It's a trip down memory lane. Right. It's like we're getting the band back together. Harrison Ford isn't going to be in all the movies.
Right.
I doubt he's going to survive episode 7.
I think everybody assumes that. I think the biggest twist would be if he did survive.
Yeah.
And was in episode 8.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think that would be the thing that everybody would be what?
I don't see that happening.
No, I don't see
that. That would be almost the opposite Game of Thrones effects. It's like you're expecting this character to die and he doesn't.
I think he'll go out. He'll go out like a badass.
I mean, of course he will. I mean, he's been asking for it.
Yeah, that's what he wanted in Return of the Jedi, and I'm almost seeing that he put those terms in his deal.
Probably.
Yeah.
I think they should kill Luke and Leia. They should kill all of
them.
Maybe. I think they'll probably
it's
all
very
go.
Possible.
By the end of episode 9, I think they'll all be
well,
gone.
Well, Luke is obviously filling the Obi-Wan Kenobi role and also the Qui-Gon Jinn role.
Yeah.
And that's just like, that's how Star Wars movies works. The mentor in every trilogy, the mentor Jedi guy has to die before the apprentice is ready.
That's how it works.
And that puts him in this tenuous position.
It'll be interesting to see because, you know, what changes they make. How do you go away from the formula and how do you keep it interesting, right? Because obviously we want to go back down memory lane, but if it's a complete rehash, then that'll bring criticism.
No, that's no good, right?
So,
it's got to
be different.
Can't just be a nostalgia fest because that's not what I want.
Nobody wants
it's not what I want.
I mean, that's one of the things about just looking at the trailers that I'm interested in. And obviously the trailers are so short, but you know, even the look, when you look at the difference between the way the prequels looked and the original trilogy looked, you know, here everything still kind of looks the same as it did. And probably they're playing that up to get you going.
Sure.
But, you know, another thing that I loved about the prequels, again, aside from the story side, is just the planet building, like you were mentioning.
Yes,
the universe
Coruscant
building,
is incredible.
You know, and I want more of that. I want something totally different. I want to see stuff I've never seen before. and I don't want to go back to Hoth.
That's the stuff why you can use CGI. You know? Give us something interesting.
You want it the same but different.
Right. Yeah.
Sure.
That's why everybody was so relieved when that planet turned out to be Jakku and not Tatooine.
Right.
Absolutely.
But Rogue One, I think, will be interesting because they're saying no Jedi, no main story. It's just like a war movie, hard. And that's going to be telling, like, if you can, if people will go see just because it's Star Wars, which I'm sure they will, but like, there's no Jedi, there's no lightsabers, there's none of this shit. Like, it's a different, something in the Star Wars universe.
I would love it if they could pull that off because that means, you know, we've got the trilogy movies that sort of fulfill these certain notes.
Right.
But then if you can use these standalone films to hit them in a different way, a different different way stylistically.
You need to.
Like, you could actually do almost a bleak, like, Taxi Driver style Star Wars movie.
And
like, that would be great if the Boba Fett movie was like that. You know, where there's no clear good guy, no clear bad guy, and it sort of doesn't end on any sort of resolution. Yeah.
And even the way that they look, even the way they look, I mean, when episode 789, I don't have to, but, you know, they have to, in a way, at least look and feel like the episodes. You know, you have a complete hopeful open rein for a director to do anything.
High visual style.
Yeah, that would be
bring
super
it in,
cool.
You know.
But it also has to be like three acts, three planets.
Right.
You know, it's like.
Yeah.
It has to...
Yeah, the formula is there. The formula works for a reason.
I would love... The Western thing, I think, is great. I think the rumors would be possibly an Obi-Wan with Ewan McGregor.
No, that's not a rumor anymore. It's called Obi-Wan, The Balance of the Force. I don't know what part of his story they're going to tell. Maybe post-Sith or pre-Phantom?
Yeah, but between Sith and... I mean, I think Ewan McGregor was one of the highlights.
Yeah,
I think he
absolutely.
Was a cool... And I would like to see him... With a real director, you know, I know he's not your friend.
It's all right.
A little bit more of a story. I mean, I think one of the things that I didn't like about the prequels is like how monastic the Jedi were and how comfortable they were with that. Anakin, of course, was all over the place, but just I was my own impression that the Jedi were a little bit more freewheeling, like the fact that they were just so strict and boring. I mean, you've got an actor like Sam Jackson, this vivid actor like Sam Jackson, and you make him so boring. Yeah.
It's interesting that's one of the things that when I read old stuff from Lucas and stuff, like I think a lot of people say, oh, he changed. And I think that in a lot of ways he stayed exactly the same. And if you go back to like Empire, he tells, you know, Yoda says, Jedi's have the most serious mind, you know, like I think that was his idea and he just stuck with it, even if it didn't work for the story, because I kind of agree.
Yeah, but they don't play with it enough.
Right, and that's the thing.
Like, Qui-Gon was an interesting character because he kind of bent the rules.
Exactly, he was bending the rules. Qui-Gon is, you know, probably my favorite character.
He was definitely the best.
He was very
one of the
cool.
best things in that. In the
wanted
first
to
movie.
See more of that. How did he never show up as a ghost?
Yes,
I
that
know,
was,
really.
Oh my God.
I know.
Okay, can I say major critique here? When Obi-Wan is on Utapau, and he has that conflict with Grievous, and he falls in that pit, and he's floating, and he's in like this half state of delirium.
Yes, that would be the time.
Perfect opportunity
the
for
time.
The spirit to show up and really show us, like you're supposed to give us something on here.
Yeah.
And just to tack it on at the end is this like, oh, go see if you can find Qui-Gon. I did. Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah. And there's no more movie. There was nothing else. That was it.
Yeah,
I
thought he was going to
Did he
back.
Not want to?
I don't know, but he came back for that Clone Wars episode.
He did. He was in one Clone Wars episode.
Blown opportunity.
But like, and like, it's we all were like, just thought that was a given.
Right.
Because we've established that people come back as ghosts.
And then you
but
heard
we've
his
also
voice in episode two.
Right, but we've also established that it wasn't. It never happened. Until
which was a cool twist, I thought.
Right.
But they just didn't give enough on that. I'm sorry. That was a mistake.
But an Obi-Wan movie, like on Tatooine, maybe exploring why him and Uncle Owen hate each other.
Because you got none of that.
Right.
You know, something happens and there's a he's gotta go help somebody. Like it's like Kane in fucking Kung Fu. He's walking Tatooine and
something. Everybody would sign on.
I mean, that was another thing that I thought they fucked up in episode two is like, you know, when Beru and Owen are talking about, oh, he's just like his father, or that's what I'm afraid of. There's this implication, like there was this big thing that happened. Nothing happened.
No payoff.
Right.
No, Uncle Owen doesn't do shit. They could have given them one scene where at least it emphasized what their conflict was and set off, at least in motion, the attitude that we see Owen with in episode four, and you just don't. And
I think that would be interesting. I mean, I'm also not super interested in them doing a ton of prequels. Like, I would almost prefer that just move forward, but it seems like we're going to get a Han Solo, young Han Solo movie.
I like the idea that at some point they can just jump around wherever.
Yeah, that's true.
I would
love
a Darth Maul film.
Sure.
That would be great.
I would love, and these can also be a television show.
That's
They've
what I
talked
always
about
thought.
That
totally.
Too.
That's what like I thought the future was going to be, was like an anthology of television.
Yeah,
or
the Chronicles or whatever. Like, you could do, I don't know if it would be a movie, but like you could definitely do an episode where it's on Kamino and one clone catches on to what's going on, and the episode is him trying to escape and what they do to sort of shut down that kind of like independent thinking in a stormtrooper. That'd be a fucking
great
hour of TV.
Yeah, great TV show. And yeah, there's so much. I mean, that's what I think people, I think directors of our generation now are, everybody probably wants to be involved, right? They all want to get their hands on here to put their
But now there's a possibility.
Yeah, now there's a possibility. Yeah.
So what's supposed to happen in The Force Awakens? Does anybody know?
I don't want
to
know.
I don't really read this. Well, I've read some spoilers. I've read a lot of spoilers.
I think even all the spoilers are almost speculation, too. I don't know if anybody's seen a script or this or that.
What's the craziest spoiler you heard?
Should I take this off?
You don't want to do this?
I totally am.
All right, let's fuck spoilers. We don't have to talk.
Yeah, no, it's okay. No, I really don't know any. I've only just sort of ancillary heard some, but I'm curious as to the relationship between what's been going on with Han, Luke, and Leia since Jedi, and I don't know if it's good.
It's not good. Yeah. It doesn't seem good, which is the smart thing to do. I mean, this is obviously they have to be at some sort of low point, and the fact that when they walk into the Millennium Falcon and Han is like, "We're home," it means that they've been separated.
He's not
from
in
the
there.
Falcon. Right. They've been separated from the Falcon for all this time.
Trapped maybe in that battle of other ships or something, maybe. They found the Falcon. Maybe it was underground or something.
Yeah, somehow they didn't like have it. And that's interesting. Yeah. I always sort of assumed that they would have always held on to it.
Yeah, I mean, that's what you would think, right?
And where the hell is Luke? He's off somewhere with R2-D.
Luke's gone.
His hand, what happened to his hand? Now he's got no hand.
I got to wager Luke's first line is going to be, "Hello there." Okay. I think that's a safe bet.
They're going to play it up like that.
Yeah, that's as much as I want.
And he's going to have a beard.
He looks great. He lost some weight. Yeah. He looks like pretty badass.
But he can get away with being an old, too. I mean, I'm warning you about Carrie Fisher.
Yeah.
I'm sure she's going to look fine.
She lost a bunch of weight, too. We saw her.
And
Comic-Con.
She doesn't need to be a sex symbol.
No.
It'd be cool if she wore the buns.
Sure.
Carrie Fisher said it'd be cool if she had the buns, but they were gray. I could fuck with that.
She's so fucking funny. She's so witty and sharp, and I would hope they let her let loose a little bit.
That's why I think Natalie Portman was not such a great choice for the female lead. She's just flat.
Yeah.
She just doesn't have that attitude. Right. What made the first movie so great was this sort of counterintuitive princess. This is supposed to be a damsel in distress, and she's like kind of this sassy bitch that's bossing her rescues around.
Right.
You know, that was such an incredible twist. And
see, I think they were going back to the Jedi, I think it's the same thing. I think they were like confined by the rules that were set up. The rules were she was a queen, so she's like humorless. And the Jedi, I feel like, and I
but Leia was a princess.
Yeah, but she was, yeah.
She just didn't have a lot of sass. There was no chemistry between her and Hayden Christensen. It's like, did you watch, who's that guy that did those long deconstructions of all the films?
Weird rapist. Mr. Plinkett, yeah.
Yeah, and he was like, he does this little montage where he just like, why does Padme like this dude? And it just shows every stupid, he's whiny, he's got a creepy metal hand, and that's like, there's no reason for her to like him, and yet she does.
That's
and they
true.
Don't give us any reason.
Maybe he minds.
Yeah, I mean, the chemistry between in Empire Strikes Back, the chemistry between Harrison Ford and Carrie Fisher, especially in that kiss scene.
That's
one of the greatest cinematic kisses ever filmed, and it's just so natural. This, when she's telling him she loves him, I'm like, do you?
You know what's funny is, some of the scenes that you mentioned do resonate for me, and I don't know if they resonate for me because of the acting, but I think they resonate for me because of the music. You know, in the arena scene when they're being wheeled out and she tells him that she loves him and the music kind of swells.
Truly,
like
deeply.
Yeah.
It worked for me.
The music is amazing.
I like the line where she said, like, he's like, I thought we said we weren't going to be in love because it would destroy our lives. And she's like, it looks like our lives will be destroyed anyway. Yeah. All right. I can fuck with that.
There's stuff. I mean,
great John Williams music, though, in all three, to your point. Yeah, which was awesome.
Yeah, and getting him back for episode 7, which is something else. I mean, all of it I didn't think would ever happen, but that was another one that I didn't really think would happen.
That's going to be a big thing. Even more so than George Lucas not being involved is John Williams not being involved.
I mean,
involved.
It's going to happen at some point.
Of course.
I mean, he's not going to be
involved. What are you talking
about? I mean, yes, he's immortal.
I'm wondering if for the new movie we're going to get a new theme, like, you know, Imperial March or something.
Yeah.
I remember one thing. We could talk about Return of the Jedi if you want.
Sure.
It's like, It's
Amit and I are huge Return of the Jedi fans. So
really, I hate Return of the Jedi.
We're a bit younger, and I think
how old are you?
35.
We're 79 born.
Okay,
that was both of our
but
first.
As,
movie.
As a grown up, I'm gonna make you hate it. The first time I realized there was something slightly wrong with Return of the Jedi was right when it came out. When I bought the soundtrack, or my mom bought it for me, and was the first Star Wars soundtrack that wasn't a double album. Mm-hmm. That was a red flag for me.
There's a lot of music, but it's a lot of mood music in that movie.
It's true.
I mean, some of it is really good.
Yeah.
You know, the It's a Trap music and all that stuff. And I love Lopty Neck.
Mm-hmm, of course.
Great.
Sure. Yeah.
Love that shit. I mean, the music on that record is great, but it just seemed like Star Wars had two records, mm-hmm. Empire had two records, and Side 2 started with the Imperial March. Right. Come on. Get out of here. There's no way. And then why does this movie only have one record? Are they kind of...
Yeah, I never understood
kinda,
that either.
Kind of dropping it a little bit. My capital problem with Return of the Jedi is not the Ewoks.
Okay.
I would have liked to see something a little bit more serious mm-hmm. in that scene. I think I love the concept of like this very primitive society being able, by the force of rightness and goodness and spirit, toppling a technologically superior force. That's thematically is great. I just thought the execution was a little too comedic. I would have still been fine with the Wookiees or the Yuuzhan or whatever else it could have been. I think the biggest failure of Return of the Jedi is the Luke and Leia relationship. It's like there's this all this setup about this other.
Right.
And how it's in, like, I can't do it alone. Mm-hmm. There's another, you know, okay, fine. Yet at the end of the day, the fact that she's his sister and Darth Vader's daughter has zero effect in the plot.
Except for
it's a good point.
Luke except using, to Vader using her,
which isn't enough because there's any number of things he could have done to provoke that reaction. Yeah. It's like, why put that in there? It's like
building it up from Jedi. I mean, from Empire for 3 years. No, there is another. Who is this other? Right. You know, sort of thing.
Yeah.
It's going to play a role.
Right.
And also just knowing who she is as a person. If she... Right. This is another thing. He's like, okay, I tell you that you're my sister. And she's like, all right, I guess I sense that because she has the Force or whatever. Oh, but guess what? By the way, Darth Vader's your father. Remember the guy that tortured you and blew up your planet? She has no reaction.
Yeah. That's true.
She doesn't
that
say
is true.
Anything doesn't say at anything. All about, oh, yeah. Darth Vader's my father and you're about to go step to him. And I'm just going to let... And what?
She's like, what the fuck?
And she just lets him go. And then she goes, hold me to hand. That she was never just a hold me type. Yeah. I think what would have been much more interesting is if she would have gone with him to confront Vader. Not necessarily fight him with a lightsaber, but go there to just push him to where he wound up. And then doing that, taking her out of Endor gives Han Solo... A problem, because now he's finally decided, oh, I love this woman, mm-hmm. and after being on the run and never wanting to commit to anything, I'm ready to commit, and now she's gone, and I have to fight this war by myself. I think it just would have given it a little bit, it would have followed through a little bit more on what they'd set up in the first two films, and I felt like in a lot of ways they just took this shorthand approach and just kind of got it done.
Right. I mean,
that's my beef with
Jedi. You know, I agree with that, and I don't disagree with that. And I think Han, like, thinking that, like being jealous of Luke, like, that doesn't work. I don't think Han would ever really think that she was going to go for Luke.
Well, I don't understand what she's like. She's like, I can't tell you. And I'm like, why? Just fucking tell Han. Yeah. Like, Luke didn't say, don't fucking tell anybody. Like, it seemed all right.
I just thought, you may as well not have even made her his sister in the first place.
So I think there was supposed to be another Jedi. When Leota says, oh, there is another... That there was rumors that
Ray Liotta
somebody.
I think when they wrote that script, they didn't know who the other was.
No, I don't think so either.
When I was a kid, I thought it was Han Solo.
Right? Could have been.
I think Han Solo has the Force.
Maybe.
He calls it luck, but it is the Force. Why does Obi-Wan, out of that whole cantina full of pilots and smugglers and people that were probably just as capable of doing that job of getting them to Alderaan, why does he pick Han Solo?
Because of Chewbacca.
Maybe Chewbacca's got the Force.
Well, I think maybe he knew Chewbacca from you know.
I don't think they ever meet, do they?
They didn't meet, but you know, he hangs out with Yoda. Yeah.
I think Han Solo has the Force, and he just doesn't know it.
Yeah.
I wonder if Leia will, because Luke says in time, you'll learn how to do it. Like, is she a fucking Jedi?
Well, that's gonna be
in the Force
super
Awakens.
Awesome. And you know, the other thing is, you know,
I don't think she
doesn't
is.
Think so. I don't think so either. Yeah.
You know, part of the, you know, wishing that this happened, and again, I'm guilty of this as anybody, but then again, when you see stuff, you know, part of the fun is imagining what happened, you know, between Owen and Ben, or what happened with Leia.
I'm with you. I don't need to see everything. You're right. I totally understand.
There's enough there for you to fill in the blanks.
Yeah. But when, you know, they say something and then they go back to that exact time, you kind of think they may touch on it just a smidge, you know, but
or just do it. Do, if you're going to do it right.
Right. But yeah, I don't know. We don't know what Leia's role will be. But Luke, I don't think we're going to probably see it to the very end.
You think so?
You know,
That was my favorite. Luke was always my guy in the originals. You know, as vanilla as it is, I love Luke. And that was what evoked emotion for me. Just that one scene. I thought everything we had seen up to that point was cool. Obviously the voiceovers, obviously the music. But when you saw Luke with R2, that's when I bought in. That was my.
You didn't even know it was him at first. But
no,
like,
but you knew.
But you knew.
You knew,
right?
Yeah, it's pretty. It's implied. Yeah. Pretty.
It's
heavily
definitely implied. And Mark Hamill, the nicest guy in the world. He kept this. They just posted a picture of him. He was at a Comic-Con in '76 promoting Star Wars. Like, he has been hustling for this franchise since before it was released. He's always been so nice to the fans. I think he's a good actor. He's just, you know, hasn't quite always got the best roles, but he's done great.
He's done great.
Great as the Joker and do all this crazy stuff. So I'm like, I want a fucking meaty with an awesome director, like an awesome character, and him to look awesome and be fucking Luke.
Yeah.
You know?
No, absolutely.
I can't wait.
That's what I'm probably the most excited about.
Like, Harrison Ford, he's going to do his Harrison Ford thing. It's great. But like, Luke, I want Luke Skywalker to like kick it.
Yeah.
And be fucking awesome.
One thing that I heard J.J. Abrams say I think maybe it was Kathleen Kennedy. I don't know. Somebody said it. But that I was kind of excited by also is that he said that for Harrison Ford, he didn't want him to do his kind of old man grumbly thing that he's been doing in the last few
movies. I heard
that
too. You can't growl in the movie.
And
you have to talk
clearly.
I thought
that's awesome.
I'm dying to know what they had to do to get Harrison Ford to come back. Because he's been vocally critical about Star Wars since it
ended. For a long time.
And a lot of the things he said, I think, were totally right on. Do you ever read The Secret History of Star Wars?
Maybe.
It's a book and a website that sort of collects all the sort of unauthorized backstory about how the films got made, and they comb old articles and interviews and really pull out like all this details that's not necessarily part of the kind of cleaned up, sanitized version of the story. And there's a lot of stuff in there about Harrison Ford just and Return of the Jedi and the Ewoks and how he didn't think it was a successful ending. And I agree with him. I don't think they should have killed him, but I think there was a lack of darkness. Like, they should have killed Wedge, at least. You know, knowing now that he doesn't want to be in the
They didn't even,
the
like, kill the Falcon or Orlando. Like there's not nobody, really. Nobody. One Ewok.
Like,
you know?
Yeah, there's that foreshadowing.
Oh,
where
that
it was like, you
it
know.
It was a baby, though.
No.
Yeah.
That was a baby.
They foreshadow that something's going to happen to the Falcon, you know, when he's like, take care of her. And all the radar dish gets broken off. Okay, fine. There should have been a bigger price to pay for the good guys.
One would think. Yeah. But he was at Comic-Con San Diego not too long ago, and he was the last person they brought in.
Harrison
Ford.
Yeah.
He's like the
huge
biggest
reveal.
Star.
Yeah.
And
I'm surprised he went to Comic-Con.
He had so many good things to say. He's like, and they called him out. Like, he's like, listen, you know, that was that. And they brought me the scripts, and it was great. And he said it was the biggest, best script he's read in years. I mean, maybe they paid him to say that. But whatever, he's the type of guy who just does it because they tell him to. Yeah. He always speaks his mind.
He's got enough money where he doesn't. He's not buyable.
Right.
You can't buy Harrison Ford. If he doesn't want to make the movie, he's not going to fucking
And they're like,
make it.
Oh, you got rid of that asshole George Lucas? No problem. You know,
possibly another beer.
Maybe that could have been it. But he always seemed like he was honest about his opinions, and he seems all on board with this. Or maybe he came around this time in his life.
I know he also has said things like he kind of never really understood the intensity of the fandom. It was always a bit perplexing to him. Maybe as he got older and as things continued to persist and it didn't go away and it turned out not to be a fad, he kind of understood how important it was.
Maybe there's something there,
And he just felt like, you know, I think everybody felt like if this is going to happen, it has to happen now because there's the window of opportunity is going to close.
Right, and we want them all. We need to have the three of them.
Have any of them.
We got to have all of them.
I always felt like it was either going to be just Luke or all three of them. I mean, I always felt like Mark Hamill would come back. I mean, he'd do anything.
Well,
But the thing is, I was totally resigned to the fact that it was never going to happen.
Right.
That's why I almost think, in a way, this is sort of almost quasi-religious, because we'd all been living with this just notion that was it. We were promised a third trilogy, but reality got in the way, and that's what we all have to accept as adults, that you don't always get your dreams don't always come true and you just have to kind of live with what you got. And then all of a sudden it's happening. Yeah. And it's just like
episode 7
with Han, Luke, and Leia. Yeah, and it's just like, are you seriously?
Yeah.
That like makes you believe in life
That's
again.
True.
Do you guys remember when the news came out with the, it was like the day after Hurricane Sandy.
Yeah.
It was just like so
I
surreal.
I found out I was looking at my phone. I was online for Star Tours in Orlando, Florida. And somebody texted me. Yeah. Because we went there and we happened to be on vacation. I was like, what? Disney just bought Star Wars? And people started texting me like, did you have something to do with this? Because they knew I was in Disney. It was so cool. And like, whoever expect? I thought maybe after George Lucas died, right, maybe there would be some more Star Wars. And I thought that
there would be more movies, but anthology stuff. I never
the
thought
the TV
be
show
an
is yeah. what they were really saying, right. And I was totally happy with that.
Yeah,
they
that
said they were going to do some like
no Star more episodes,
right.
right?
No more episodes. That's what I thought there'd be no more episodes.
And Harrison Ford doesn't want to do it anyway.
Right. But
should we touch real briefly on Indy 5? Is that or is
sure.
that even relevant at all?
Is it going to happen? Yeah. What do we think?
With Chris,
or
with Chris Pratt
or indie reboot, right? Maybe.
Yeah. Well, yeah, Chris yeah. Pratt said he wasn't going to do it, or they hadn't. That was just like an internet thing. I don't know if that.
Fuck him. Would he be good as Indiana? Can we live with Indiana Jones not being Harrison Ford?
I don't know if I could. I'll be perfectly
honest. I'd rather
honest.
See old Harrison
I
Ford
like
than like
old,
a young. Yeah.
I agree. I agree.
At least one more,
at
right?
One
you know,
more.
I feel like he still looks good.
Yeah,
you know?
He can still do it.
But
I like they, you know, they played up the oldness in the last.
Yeah,
one
that's,
and stuff.
That's
that
fine.
Fun.
I mean, the thing is, Indiana Jones was never a superhero anyway.
Right,
I mean,
exactly.
He was always blundering his way
yes.
through it.
Yeah.
So it doesn't matter if he's old, and yeah. they can fake it if he can't necessarily do all the stunts.
Sure.
Although he still seems,
he still
pretty,
seems
fit.
Pretty good.
If it's not now, though, we'll get a younger one
yeah,
at some
right,
point.
At
probably.
Some point. I mean, well, I guess in Young Indy Chronicles, people have played him before. I don't know if you. I don't know. Would you think Chris Pratt now being on like multiple franchises, like, is it too recognizable for him to be in this, or do you not care?
If it's good, I don't care.
Yeah.
I don't know if he's perfect for Han. Han is like a little bit more tall, dark, and handsome-y mm-hmm. sort of a guy.
Yeah, but who, I mean,
I don't know.
I was looking on Huffington Post and there was an article about like 15 young actors in Hollywood. I was looking at Huffington Post and there was a thing like 15 young actors in Hollywood who could potentially play the young Han Solo.
Okay.
Nothing.
Nobody.
Nothing.
Yeah.
Not even fucking close.
Yeah.
Harrison Ford is so inimitable. There's no way
yeah.
you can do that. But I'm going to guess whoever they cast as young Han Solo is also going to play Indiana Jones.
I mean, come on, right?
Kinda
how cool would
sense.
That be?
There may be some unknown actor that could
yeah,
conceivably
pull
it off.
There's this
that's
dude.
The only way, I think. I can't.
Yeah.
If you start seeing other people, sometimes it's hard. I mean,
there is
I
this
know.
Dude. I can't remember his name right now, but he played Harrison Ford in like a lower budget movie. It was like a biography movie. And he's amazing. He does an amazing like... It's an impression, but it's not just an impression. I'm like, hire that dude.
Does he look like him?
Yeah, well, the way he delivers his lines and he sort of looks like a young guy. But that might be the way to go, a more
maybe.
Unknown type person.
I think it has.
I mean,
Ryan Gosling, they've mentioned, you know, for Han Solo, maybe.
No. I mean, that was what the original strength of the first Star Wars was, is like you didn't know who any of those
right.
actors
right.
were,
yeah.
so you...
And
they
a cool
were those
thing
characters.
About episode 7 too is that I don't you don't really you know obviously it's in this day and age John Boyega and stuff but you don't know those guys.
Well, they're not necessarily they're identified not, with anything
sure.
really big.
Right. So Oscar Isaacs is going to be sort of the Han Solo
right.
guy. He's a little bit older.
Poe Dameron.
Yeah. Excellent. I don't even know all those guys yet. Yeah. Daisy Ridley is and John Boyega.
Yeah.
Those are the three.
Those are the three.
That's the new ones.
Yeah.
There's an interesting cast. I mean, Adam Driver is an interesting choice
yeah.
to play the villain,
yeah.
and Gwendolyn Christie, I think, is
badass.
Yeah.
I can't
great.
Wait for her.
Yeah.
She's gonna fucking kill
perfect.
It as a big, giant, awesome chick stormtrooper. Mm-hmm. Fucking
chrome stormtrooper.
So cool. I tell
with
you,
with a fucking cape,
that badass looking right. One of the things that really sold me on the new Star Wars was at Celebration. When they brought out BB-8
mm-hmm.
onto the stage. And like we saw him in the trailer and you just were like...
And it was a real thing.
Well, yeah. You're like, that's a CG effect. Okay, fine,
sure.
And then he fucking rolled out and yeah. I like felt like I was 8 years old again. Like how did they... I know so much about special effects.
Right.
But I couldn't figure
yeah.
out how they did it, and it was perfect.
Yeah, that's fun. That's
like, holy shit.
Innovation part is
you know,
super
like
fun.
Amazing.
Yeah.
So I'm like, awesome, a robot
yeah.
that I'm super into.
He was. I remember in that Vanity Fair article, I think they were talking about J.J. and was saying how one of the effects was just like this puppet on a plank, and you just hit the back of the plank, and it pops up.
Awesome. Awesome. That's all you need.
Does he burp when he pops up? Or no?
He farts.
He farts.
Yeah, of course. Those are the kind of practical effects I'm sure he'll be CG sometimes.
Of course.
They say that shot in that trailer was practical, yeah. so I don't know.
As long as you don't notice, that's all that matters.
Right? Yes, I agree.
And only little light touches of possible narrative. Like, there hasn't been a narrative trailer yet.
Not
it's
at
just,
all.
And I'm all, that's
I
all
really
I want.
Hope they don't for the last one, too. I don't want to know anything.
They don't need to.
But
it's fucking
Star
Wars.
Wars. People are going to be there.
Black screen that says Star Wars. That's all you need. You know, you don't need much more than that.
No.
I'm really curious as what the plot is going to be or what's the driving factor going to be. I've heard some things. You know, obviously there's some new empire rising, the First Order, and that there's this new Sith guy that's causing trouble.
Yeah,
and I heard something interesting that he wasn't necessarily going to be portrayed as pure evil.
Okay,
that he's sort of just like an ambitious person who feels entitled to things because he has this power. And that the real bad guys were the Imperials.
Interesting.
But, and then something happens that sets off this chain of motion where Leia sends Han to find Luke because something that only Luke can handle. Hmm. And they probably haven't seen each other for a long
time. That's what it seems. Yeah.
It's going to be like the Blues Brothers.
Putting the band back together.
I would watch it.
Yeah. And, you know, there's the lightsaber obviously seems to play a part in it.
Right.
I think the bad guy, the broadsaber thing, is pretty cool. Like, it looks like it's handmade.
And how staticky and kind of
like
unstable it looks. Yeah, I think that's
threw it together.
They stole that from me, by the way.
Yeah?
Yeah, well, in Toy Lords of Chinatown, episode one, when the Sucklord reveals his laser sword, it has this like electrical effect, and it just has, you know, it has the light. I use the lightsaber sound effect, but then I put this like electricity crackle, you know, just to imply that somehow it's a little more ghetto.
Very cool.
Or it's like a transistor saber.
I hope Chewie doesn't die. I hope he stays around forever. You know,
he was of all the things, I think I was most disappointed that they didn't age Chewbacca.
I thought a little bit of gray hair.
No, he looked even younger.
Yeah.
He looked
younger.
Really tight.
A little gray hair would be fine.
Exactly.
Or a lot of gray hair.
We saw some in the episode 3 Wookiees. There was a couple that had gray hair. I totally was
he could still be fit.
Yeah, sure.
Still
or maybe not. I mean, what
fat Chewbacca, sure.
We could get more on Chewbacca or like some vulnerability from Chewbacca.
But some of those characters who aren't slave to actors could keep being in these forever. The droids and Chewbacca.
Absolutely.
And, I mean, Admiral Akbar is back. Yeah, Nub is back.
Yeah, that's right. What's up with that?
Yeah, I saw that too. I wasn't sure if that was actually going to be there or they're just kind of showing stuff.
Or was it Admiral Akbar? Or
was it some other monk?
I think there was some confirmation.
Was there?
Akbar. I mean, I don't know how much, but that he would be in it. Yeah, and then Nub.
Yeah, Nub.
but no Wedge.
But no Wedge.
No
she
mention
said
of
no.
Wedge and no mention of Billy Dee.
No Wedge. Said
yeah,
no.
But what's his name? Dawson.
Dennis Lawson.
Dennis Lawson said no.
Yeah,
I don't want to do it.
He's like, I don't care.
He's like, Star Wars is boring. Billy Dee Williams is not in great shape. I mean, he's
in
a
pretty
wheelchair.
Old. But he wants in. He said.
But what are they going to do with him? I mean,
He was on Rebels. It was a pretty good episode.
I didn't like that episode.
I thought his character was a little over the top.
It was interesting seeing like a younger Lando that was still kind of hustling.
Right.
You know, like he didn't have Cloud City.
Yeah.
We don't know if he has the Falcon at the time.
Yeah.
It didn't seem,
they didn't
like,
seem
he
like it. I would assume they would have done that if he had it. I'm sure they would have put it in there.
Let's talk about Rebels for a minute.
Yeah. Sure. I actually haven't seen too many of them yet.
I'm
behind.
You fucking suck
you
as
have
a Star
a
Wars fan. You're fucking out of here.
I'm behind.
You're out of here.
I'm behind.
It's
actually,
fucking incredible.
It's
I haven't seen the first episode of season 2, but
I saw the whole
I can't wait
all
to
on
see
my DVR.
It.
Yeah.
I thought they did a really good job with it. You can see where they, you know, with the Clone Wars, it took a couple of years to really hit its stride. And with this one, I thought it took only like a few episodes to hit its stride. And then
well,
by
they're
the
working
end,
in a more favorable time period.
Yeah.
Like
no,
have
absolutely.
Empire already exists. You have stormtroopers.
Right,
you
exactly.
can have put Tarkin. You can put Vader in it.
Yeah.
You just got more to work with.
Yeah. And I mean, you're building the characters to the point where you like them as opposed to jumping around with the Clone Wars. You had a lot, some episodes about the clones, some episodes about the Jedi. So, I mean, you definitely get invested in the characters.
It's also weird because with the Clone Wars, you kind of already know how Obi-Wan and Anakin end up. So there's not that dramatic tension there. This story, we don't know so much. And actually what's weird is like this, I guess this kind of has been, my theory has been blown away by the Rogue One announcement that that's supposedly the story of how they steal the Death Star plans.
Yeah.
I always thought Kanan and the Rebels crew were going to be those guys.
Sure.
Yeah.
And that somehow they were going to die in the process, which explains why they aren't around.
Yeah.
Maybe not.
Do you think we're going to see any live action versions of these characters
Well, you're spoiler free, but I've heard some things.
I'm okay for Rogue One.
For episode 7.
Episode 7. All right, then I don't want to.
Okay. I think it'd be cool if we saw Ahsoka at some point, maybe, you know, live action. They could get that same chick, the player who does the voice. Yeah. Like, she looks great. Yeah.
I don't know what they're going to do with Ahsoka. I thought that was an interesting twist that they really brought her in.
I thought that was great. A direct connection, you know, to it. That was what my wife and I, we started rewatching The Clone Wars because she hasn't seen it. So we're going to go right through The Clone Wars and right into Rebels. You know?
I've seen some really pretty hot Ahsoka porn, too. I jerked off to it.
Yeah?
You know, whenever you just sometimes when you're decided, okay, it's masturbation time, I'm going to go on the internet and just pursue whatever happens to be tickling my fancy right now. And there was a moment when I was just like, let's see what the Ahsoka stuff is.
You can imagine it.
And there's some
it.
Good Ahsoka bukkake out there.
Really?
Yeah.
I don't think I've seen much with Ahsoka. Plenty of the other
I've seen some great slave Leia gangbang drawings and stuff like that.
There's like real scenes like with people just dressed like slave Leia. Several slave Leias I've seen. Lesbian scenes.
Really? I've seen some. I watched part of the Star Wars porno movie. It just...
that wasn't my favorite.
It didn't quite click with me, but just like... The tune stuff has been really good.
They do crazy stuff now. Like, they'll use the actual shows, and they can just manipulate the cartoons themselves. So it's like they'll like serious production value you'll see on these.
That's
all
made in Korea, isn't it?
Yeah, I assume. But episode 7, The Force Awakens. Are we doing another line, or you guys want to stay on the line again?
It's December. Mm-hmm. That's a problem.
At this point, as hot as I am right now, that would be wonderful.
There's no reason to wait online.
Even with
Revenge of the Sith, the line was symbolic.
It was symbolic.
Totally symbolic
at that point.
How are we going to get into the movie at the first day at the Ziegfeld? That's
the
question.
And so hopefully we still have some connections there where we can at least get
Are you pursuing this? Or
it's been thrown around, but everybody's like old and tired. We're like hoping somebody will be like the guy, maybe it's Rob, who will be the guy who, like, you know, because, you know, real world and jobs.
The Ziegfeld has changed management a few times.
You know, it's not what it used to be.
No, there's nothing.
There's nothing there.
It's not there.
But we still need to see it there. I mean, we just have to, right?
I can't imagine being like that guy who didn't see the first show.
No, absolutely. No,
like, there's people in the world, like regular civilians, not press people or Hollywood people or connected people. I'm hoping to be a connected person.
Okay.
All I got to do is get connected in the next couple of months.
I can't imagine you won't get connected. Well, you want to see it before the first like public showing? You want to see like one of the charity events or something like that? Or
I'd do that,
You want to see it as soon as humanly possible.
I just want to get it over with. I just want to get it. It's like your virginity in high school. You just want to get it over with.
You just want
to
do it.
Yeah. Just so I don't have to wonder.
Interesting, because I mean, obviously, I'd hate the waiting, but seeing it in the packed audience with the people who love it, like, for the first time.
Yeah, but I don't need to have it be the first time for me.
Okay.
It's like, I that's what happened. Like, I saw Phantom Menace and Clones. The Clone story is a tragedy, but I don't want to tell you. But I saw them both opening night.
Okay.
I didn't see Clones at the Ziegfeld.
Oh,
I saw that on 34th Street, and it broke my heart. It's like, I made some commitment.
We could have gotten you a ticket.
It wasn't about not getting the ticket. I made some commitment to some friends, and I got my loyalties got torn, and I missed it at the Ziegfeld. But I saw Phantom Menace there, and I saw them both on the. I actually saw a preview of Clones.
Okay.
At Tribeca Film Fest with the 501st, and that was cool. And then I saw Sith a week in advance. I was out on the line. And one of the guys that was running the line had an extra advance press pass. And I took it. And I remember there was a lot of contention because there were some people who were like, don't take that ticket. You got to go in with the fans. And I was just like, I just have to do this. It's just like, I just have to. And then I went and then I came out and it was just like the division, or there's this gulf between the people that were waiting and you were one of the ones that already saw it, and they didn't want to talk to you, they didn't want to risk hearing anything, and it was just like it was like this sort of elitism versus the people, and it was
I remember
really
all that,
really
and like I never gave a shit. I'm like, you want to go see it?
But I'm glad I saw it, you know, because the problem with seeing it with the fans is like everybody's making so much fucking noise.
There is
that. I can't hear everything that's going on. At least with the press screening, people were civil, and I can hear the fucking dialogue.
Yeah, there was a lot of that. There was a lot of that.
But all right, well, December, what is it?
19th?
19th?
17th?
19th?
I don't know. If it's the 17th and we show up on the 19th, that would be bad, right?
I don't know what date it's actually going to come out. Probably the Wednesday at 7 p.m.
Probably.
You know, for early shows or something, but
you'll get your chance to see it.
I am stoked.
We'll see it, I'm sure, multiple times, too.
Star Wars Episode 7.
I saw Phantom Menace 10 times in the theater.
Yeah.
Even though, like, I hated it.
Me too, man. It's crazy how much money, how many times I saw it.
Yeah. I was like, it was weird. I went through this whole thing. It's like dating a girl that you're not sure about. It's like, oh, the first date sucked. Second date, okay, maybe I do like this and this and this. Third date, oh, no, this is all wrong. Fourth date, yeah, I really, really dig this. Fifth time, sixth time, this sucks. You know, I was just like, ugh. Every time I saw it, I had a different reaction.
That's right on point. That's exactly how
I
felt as
over?
Well. Yeah, we're wrapping.
Why, did we hit an hour already?
Yeah, it's about an hour. We could keep talking.
I could do this for
another hour. We'll come back. Okay. We'll come back and we'll do another one. Maybe after we can get our reactions, and hopefully we're not all furious about The Force Awakens, and we're looking forward to the next. Well, thanks everybody for joining us on the CCD podcast. Be sure to check us out at ccd.nyc and the Sucklord at suckadelic.com and at the Sucklord on Instagram. Is that correct?
Yes.
Amit, thank you.
Thanks, Rob.
Sucklord, thanks so much for hosting us here in the Suckhole.
This place is awesome.
Maybe we
really
should do
cool.
this again, like after the film comes out.
That would be a great idea.
That would be a great idea.
I think that would be cool. We can talk about what we thought about it.
I love how, just like at this age, you know, there's still this incredibly mythic milestone approaching.
Yeah. Fucking Star Wars, it's man. Star Wars.
Where there's like pre episode 7 and post episode. Yeah. Like episode 8 is probably not quite gonna. It's gonna be awesome.
Sure, yeah. Of course.
But this is different. This is a one-time deal.
Right.
This is the first time we're getting a new Star Wars movie when we didn't think we were going to get one.
Exactly.
And now they're going to come out forever. So by like episode 9 and then all the one-offs, we're going to be used to
it.
Yeah,
we'll be used to it.
So it's not going to be quite
as
transformational.
I hope it's still fun, just like episode 3
yeah, exactly.
was different than episode 1.
Sure.
But like,
yeah,
know.
But...
This is
yeah.
it.
No, this,
the,
is
this,
it.
Is
this
is it.
This is
if,
it.
And then I'm sure a lot of people, and almost it seems like they are pretending the prequels didn't happen. It's just been 30 years since we had a Star Wars movie, and bam, here's the sequel that you guys have been waiting for.
Well, yeah, the characters. I mean, that's the thing. You're seeing these guys who you grew up with now, 30 years later. I mean, that's awesome.
All right. Well, thanks a lot, everybody.
And it's all still good.
It's all still good. We're all on board with Star Wars.
We can still fuck.
We can still fuck. CCD.nyc, thanks so much for joining us on the podcast. We'll see you nerds next time. Later. Bye-bye. I'm a Jedi. I'm a Jedi. I'm a Jedi. I'm a Jedi. You are not a Jedi. You are not a Jedi. You are not a Jedi yet. You are not a Jedi. You are not a Jedi. You are not a Jedi yet. I'm a Jedi. I'm a Jedi. I'm a Jedi. Like my father before me. Jedi.